Hi, everyone. I just saw a few people type in the chat box that they can't hear me. So if you can hear me, can you please just type in the chat box, and then we'll get started. Great. So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for this month's Teach Educational Rounds. Here with us, we have Dr. Nadia Minian and Dr. Peter Selby, who will be presenting on Do Clinical Decision Support Systems, Help Practitioners Adherence to Evidence-Based Guidelines. But before I hand it off to our presenters, I'm just going to go over a few housekeeping slides as per usual. So first of all, if you are interested in obtaining a letter of completion for this month's Teach Educational Rounds, please make sure that you have registered for this webinar and completed the pre-learning assessment. You have signed in to view this webinar using your first and your last name. And finally, you complete the evaluation and post-learning assessment, which will be emailed to you this afternoon, and you'll have 1 week to complete it. These webinars are being live tweeted on Twitter, and you can follow us at PSQuitSmoking or use the hashtag TeachWebinar to post or read questions. Here's a biography of our first faculty presenter, Dr. Nadia Minian, who is a developmental psychologist who has been trained as an implementation scientist. As a scientist at the NDS here at CAMH, Dr. Minian leads the knowledge translation team supporting the implementation, evaluation, and sustainability of evidence in practice. Her work ensures that the NDS is continuously striving towards delivering the highest quality and the most efficient services possible so that the best outcomes can be achieved for Ontario smokers. She has no disclosures to report. And here's a biography of our second faculty presenter, Dr. Peter Selby, who is the Chief of Medicine in Psychiatry Division and a clinician scientist at CAMH. He's a professor in the Departments of Family and Community Medicine, Psychiatry, and the Dalhousie School of Public Health at University of Toronto. He is also a clinician scientist in the Department of Family and Community Medicine. His research focuses on innovative methods to understand and treat addictive behaviors and their comorbidities. He also uses technology to combine clinical medicine and public health methods to scale up and test health interventions. So welcome. And here are his disclosures to report, as well as our disclosures. And this is just a friendly reminder that the content of the Teach Educational Rounds are primarily based on the evidence-based guidelines from the following sources. These materials, as well as the verbal presentations and any discussions, set out only general principles, and they do not replace the need for individualized clinical treatment plans by healthcare providers. So before I hand it off to our presenters, I'm just going to do a few polling questions to gauge who has joined us here today. So in a minute, could you please indicate with your computer what your current or what of the organizations you work for? And you should see it on your screen now. And if your organization isn't here, you can type it in the chat box. So I see some public health units are going up here, some family health teams. Great, thank you. And again, using your computer, could you please indicate what your current discipline is? And you may need to scroll down to see all the options. So we have some health promoters and educators. I see some registered nurses. Great. And finally, for the last poll, could you please indicate which region your organization serves? So we have some central area, Waterloo, Toronto, Central East, Eastern, okay. Great, thank you everyone. And without further ado, I'll hand it to our presenters.
Thank you very much, Stephanie, and hello to everyone. My name is Nadia Minian, and today's talk has three different objectives. The first is to describe the cancer risk associated with alcohol use. The second one is to summarize a study we did, which we call the COMBAT study. And the third is to discuss the implications of this study. I will be leading the first two objectives, and Dr. Selby will lead the discussion. So So as many of you probably know, alcohol is a proven carcinogen. Since the beginning of the 20th century, we've known that alcohol use or consumption causes cancer. And in 1988, the International Association for Cancer Research defined alcohol use as a group one carcinogen. That means that there is enough evidence to know that drinking alcohol causes cancer. And most of the cancer that it causes is related to the head and neck. So as this graph shows, you can see it causes oral cavity, cancer, pharynx, larynx, esophagus cancers, but it's also related to the digestive system, so the liver, the pancreas, and the colorectal cancer. For women, it's also associated with breast cancer. And in 2010 in Ontario, it was estimated that it was causing around 1,000 to 3,000 of the cancers that were diagnosed were due to alcohol consumption. In this graph here, we show the proportion of Ontario cancers cases that are attributed to cancer, that are attributed to alcohol consumption, sorry. And as you can see, it varies quite a bit between males and females and between the different types of cancer. People who smoke are more likely to be drinking above guidelines in Ontario. So as we can see here, overall, there's 27% of smokers in Ontario who are drinking above guidelines versus 16% of non-smokers that drink above guidelines. And this is really concerning because the risk of cancer due to dual consumption, that's due to alcohol, using alcohol and tobacco use, increases dramatically. Here we show the number that it's 35 times the risk of getting oropharyngeal cancer if you're using heavy consumption of both of these products. So it's not an additive risk, so it's not just the risk of smoking and the risk of drinking alcohol, it's a multiplicative risk that happens. So it's really concerning when both these behaviors go together. So we wanted to see what was happening with our STOP participants. As most of you probably know, STOP is a program designed to help patients who want to quit smoking quit. And we saw that STOP participants were more likely to be drinking above guidelines than smokers around the Ontario province, as well as non-smokers. So quite concerning for us. And we saw that their quit success at 6 months was much lower between those who were drinking above guidelines versus those who weren't. And this was across all the limbs. And this was not surprising given that a lot of research has shown that when people drink and are trying to quit smoking, they have their ability to resist the cigarette is much lower, their likelihood of smoking sooner increases, and the number of cigarettes that they smoke also increases. Fortunately, we have a lot of research showing that if we integrate a brief screening and very brief intervention into a smoking cessation program, we can help people who are drinking above guidelines reduce their alcohol use, reduce their cancer risk, and that this leads to better quit outcomes, it leads to reduced drinking rates, it increases patients' acceptance and interest in the treatment, and it increases the long-term severity. So by integrating a screening and brief intervention for alcohol, we can achieve quite a lot. Unfortunately, we don't know what is the best way to help healthcare providers that are delivering this STOP program incorporate this evidence into their daily practice. And this is not surprising. There's lots of research showing that it takes about 17 years to really, from when we know something works to incorporating into practice. And only 14% of this research is of research in general is incorporated into practice. If we put this in financial terms, we see that globally we're spending over $200 billion of healthcare research dollars. And 85% of this research dollars are wasted because they are never put into practice. So So while we want to go from bench side to bedside, it seems we're going from bench side to a bookshelf, and a dusty bookshelf that doesn't get much use. And when we look into why this could be possible and what could be done, we see that a lot of times we're incorporating research into practice using what has been called as the Islagat principle. And if you don't know what this is you use approaches that seem like a good idea at the time but have very little evidence behind them. And at the Nicotine Dependent Services at CAMH, we did not want to use this approach. So thanks to funding we received from the Canadian Cancer Society Research Institute, in 2015, we were able to design a study that would look into what would help healthcare providers deliver a screen for alcohol and deliver a brief intervention to the smokers. And there was a lot out there showing that a computerized clinical decision support system, which I will be calling CDSS for short, was a way to help practitioners adhere to evidence-based guidelines. And what a CDSS really is a computer alert. So in the case for the stop practitioners, it would be an alert that says, this patient is drinking above guidelines and this is what you should do. And what they should do depended on whether the patient was drinking above cancer guidelines but not at risk of dependence, or if they were at risk of dependence. So if they were just drinking above cancer guidelines but not at risk of dependence, there was a resource created to help them reduce their drinking. If they were drinking so much that they were at risk of dependence, the guidelines called for an abstinence resource. So that's what we created. And we designed the study with the most rigorous methodology, which was a cluster randomized controlled trial. And what that really means is that half of the sites were randomly assigned to receive the CDSS, so the prompt that would alert them that their patient was drinking above guidelines, if that was the case, and what to do. The other half of the sites were randomized to the control arm, which meant that they had access to the same screening questions to know if their patients were drinking above guidelines and to the same resources, but there was no alert given to them telling them what to do. Our primary outcome was to know if the CDSS was affecting the number of practitioners that offered an appropriate educational resource to eligible patients. Our secondary outcome was whether the number of patients that accepted the offered resource varied between the CDSS group and the non-CDSS group. And our tertiary outcome was the only one that was really measured at the patient level, and it was to measure whether patients were abstinent from smoking and were consuming alcohol within guidelines at their 6-month follow-up. So what we did is we randomized 222 clinics. One was actually ended up being excluded because they never used the STOP portal, which was an eligibility criteria to be part of this study. So 221 clinics were randomized to either the CDSS group or to the control group. And we stratified according to whether sites were big or small and what type of sites they were, so whether they were family health teams, CHCs, or nurse practitioner-led clinics. And what that meant was that we were able to really make sure that the same number of big clinics, family health teams, community health centers, and nurse practitioner-led clinics were in the control arm versus the intervention arm. And as you can see, our randomization worked very well, as we had very similar baseline characteristics between the two study arms. At the patient level, most of our patients, no matter whether they were in the intervention arm or the control arm, were around 48 years old, 55% were males, around 70 or a bit over 70% had graduated high school. Most of them had a household income below 40,000. About 50% of them were currently employed. Most of them were smoking daily and were drinking about 10 drinks a day in the week before their baseline was assessed. We also looked at whether the characteristics of the clinics were similar between the two study arms, and they were. They recruited about 31 participants, both in the intervention and the control arm, and they had joined the STOP study program at around the same amount of time. So what did we find? About 15,222 smokers were eligible to be screened, and 15,150, so almost all of them, 99.6%, were actually screened for alcohol. This is huge. Very few healthcare providers screen for alcohol in primary care, so achieving this was quite a compliment for all of you who did the screening. Thank you. 5,715 smokers were identified as drinking above guidelines, and about 50% of these smokers were offered a brief intervention, and only 19% of the smokers actually accepted the offer of the resource that the practitioner was giving them. What does this mean in terms of whether the CDSS made a difference or not? We did some logistic regressions to find out, and we saw that for our primary outcome, which you might recall was the offering of the educational resource, the CDSS made no difference on whether a practitioner was likely to offer an educational resource, the appropriate educational resource to an eligible patient or not. However, for a secondary outcome, we saw a difference that meant that patients that were random, that were assigned to a clinic that had the CDSS were more likely to accept the resource than those that were assigned to a clinic that was assigned to not receive the CDSS support. So that meant that the CDSS was not really affecting whether a healthcare provider decided to offer an educational resource, but was changing how the educational resource was being offered, or something between the interaction between the patient and the healthcare provider that made patients more likely to accept the resource. When we saw whether patients in the CDSS arm were more likely to quit smoking and be drinking above within guidelines, we saw that there was no difference between the two study groups. If you want to read a bit more about the study, we have published it in Implementation Science. I think it was published last month in 2019. It's open access, so you have full access to it. And with that, I'll thank you for your time and pass it to Dr. Selby that will be leading the discussion on what this implication could mean for us.
So, hi everybody. Thank you, Nadia, for that. Part of it is this, it's very interesting as we live in this new world of there's so much to get done, and as we've been looking at smoking cessation, what is affecting people's success? And when we start looking at people as, you know, not just smokers, but people who have full lives and what comorbidities, and as they're coming into care, it's becoming quite apparent to us that people who smoke are much more likely to be have other conditions, not only negative social determinants of health, but other health behaviors that make it hard to quit smoking, and also to make it very difficult for them, you know, and compounds the effect. So if we want to help people quit smoking, and as smoking is moving into this population that has less education, less means, we've got to start taking a look at them as all the other behaviors. So I think this was the first example. But it's all very well to say that, but then how do you help practitioners deal with all these multiple things? The great thing is that, in primary care and primary care settings, we have the opportunity and the privilege of seeing people over time. So even though we may start something at one time, we can continue with that. And I think study is really real world, trying to see how can we actually assist people do that. So just so that we can start thinking about it, and some of the issues that came up in the study that made us wonder about practitioners is this first poll question, and I'm going to see if I can have anybody bring it up, and there it is. So oops, it disappeared from my screen, but here it is. So here's the question. Is, you know, when we are going to tell people about alcohol consumption. So, I mean, you know, there are guidelines that, independent of alcohol, of tobacco, alcohol consumption guidelines, you know, are there, and they've been there for years. So at what level of alcohol consumption would you take action with the patient? Having a drink containing alcohol 2 to 3 times a week, having 3 or 4 drinks on a typical day when they're drinking, often having 5 or more drinks on one occasion, guilt or remorse about their drinking. And just to get a sense of where people are, and feel free to, you know, not vote if you don't think that is important. So generally we have about 8% who said they would have you know, interviewing with people about who are drinking 2 to 3 times a week, but the bulk of people are saying 3 to 4 drinks on a typical day when they are drinking, or 5 or more drinks on one occasion. So let's just in the interest of time, let's move forward to the poll. End the poll if I can. Yeah, perfect. And no, don't bring the second question up. I actually, I don't know if you can pull that poll up again. I think I'll just debrief and get people to comment on it. So here's the issue when you're talking about drinks. A drink for one person may be, you know, 3 fingers of a drink in a small glass. For the other, they may not even consider wine or beer as alcohol. And so it's really important when we ask the question of drink is that we use a standard format of drink or alcohol. So when we say a standard drink, it's a standard drink in Canada has 13.6 grams of alcohol. And that is the amount of alcohol, you know, the volume of drink will vary depending on the concentration. So for example, one bottle of beer, the 355 ml of beer has about 5% alcohol. Has 13.6 grams of alcohol. 5 ounces of wine has the same amount of alcohol, and 1.5 ounces of hard liquor has 13.6 grams of alcohol. Now here's the thing, when people are drinking nowadays, if you've noticed, beers, generally people are buying the half pint or a pint of beer and the tall cans. And so if you don't ask the patient how much they're drinking, and what they're drinking, you won't have an idea of what standard drinks they are consuming. So that's one thing to keep in mind. So the quantity can vary. And, you know, often people don't measure their drinks when they're at home, and so they may be pouring more than 1.5 ounces of hard liquor. So it's really a good point to try to get them to think about it as to what are they actually consuming. And so so that's when they're drinking, that's an important thing. The other thing I think we need to think about is the pattern of drinking and what is the threshold for when we would consume. So the pattern of drinking, and one thing as before we go to the next poll question is to think about what are the patterns of drinking and the amounts of drinking that are of concern. So if we can go up to the next question, next poll question, please, that'd be great. And again, feel free to type in the comment section so that we can start seeing some of your questions as they come up. So now is the next question. What are some of the barriers to bringing up alcohol with a patient? And we're hearing time, stigma, patient doesn't want to discuss it. We can see a lot of time, stigma, denial, judgment, lack of knowledge with the guidelines, lack of awareness that it is a problem. The healthcare provider used themselves, absolutely. What they were there for, They weren't there to talk about alcohol, and suddenly you're bringing something up that they weren't there to think about it. It seems like an invasion. So what you bring up here is not an uncommon reason. You know, alcohol consumption has been normalized in Canadian culture, and it's very fascinating to me when you look at some of the results, and you know, there's some good examples of surveys done amongst young people in Canada and the U.S. and England, and you know, there's a lot of concern about vaping by youth, but when you look at the alcohol consumption, it's way over the top, and nobody's talking about, my God, we got to do something about this really horrific alcohol consumption pattern amongst young people, which is causing them to get into fights, fall, injure themselves, get intoxicated, high rates of emergency room visits. So, and you know, we see alcohol ads and lifestyle ads and alcohol sponsorship of all sorts of things, and in society, alcohol is not deemed to be as harmful, although it is very harmful. So, and you heard Nadia and Dr. Minian talk about alcohol and cancer, and you know, most Canadians don't realize that alcohol is a carcinogen just by itself. It doesn't matter. It is a carcinogen. It is not like with cigarettes where it's the method of delivery and combustion that is a carcinogen. It's actually, in this case, alcohol itself. So, I mean, if you actually had consumed non-alcoholic beverages, you have no carcinogen exposure. So we, as a society, have grown up with alcohol, and most Canadians drink alcohol to some degree. So having said that, I think we also need to understand where the stigma comes from, that any talk of alcohol, if we bring it up, means as a healthcare provider, we are trying to assume that the person is an alcoholic. And here's the thing, that with every person who drinks alcohol, there's a dose-response relationship with the harms caused by alcohol. So, you know, previously it used to be believed that there was some health benefit to small amounts of alcohol consumption, and that it was good for your heart, etc. But that benefit only accrues to middle-aged men who have high risk of heart disease, and only if they drink 1 to 2 standard drinks every other day. The problem with it is, as soon as you start becoming a regular daily use of alcohol, it causes problems. But you're right, the stigma of bringing it up is there. And the beauty of it is that simple education about alcohol has been shown to help people reduce the alcohol consumption. And just simply presenting information, people bring it under control. They're not alcoholic, like the traditional sense where they're, they have that. But what we do need to realize that is in every sort of primary care practice, for every one person who might meet the criteria for being alcoholic or alcohol use disorder, you'll have 4 patients who are actually drinking to excess. They're functioning, they're doing well, they're, you know, good, upstanding members of society, they don't have any, you know, legal problems, etc., but they're drinking to excess that the alcohol is causing them health problems. And it's it's not necessarily health problems that are easily detectable, but they are causing themselves accruing risk. So the question is, how do we bring up that conversation in a way that signals that this is important, and the intervention is critical. So from a stigma perspective, actually using questionnaires like the audit and actually embedding it with the smoking and other health behaviors reduces the stigma. And in many ways, I feel like, and actually it's been shown that actually, and the study we showed actually, is that, you know, it was part and parcel, so people just answered it, and there was no pushback about answering the question. So embedding it and normalizing the asking of the question, the screening of the questions, without the judgment, is a critical piece of this. So that is one way in which we as healthcare providers can help reduce the stigmas by asking it about just pattern and frequency and how much they're using is an important way. Now, the issue about feeling judged is obviously, I think people can see us. So if, you know, when somebody says to us they're drinking daily and they're drinking, binging every, you know, week, and our eyebrows rise, they're obviously going to feel judged. But if we can keep a calm demeanor in here and thank the person for being honest with us, then clearly that judgment reduces. Now, with respect to time, part of it is when somebody's there for one condition and they you seem like you're asking about other things, they wonder why it's there. Every question that we ask around smoking is related to either helping them quit smoking or making it harder to quit smoking. So for example, we know when the people are depressed, they're a third less likely to quit smoking. If they're drinking alcohol, they have much less success rate. If they're drinking coffee and it's connected, it's hard to quit. If they are having pain medications, you know it's going to be hard for quitting. So all of those questions, interestingly enough, all come in the way. But although we may know those connections, the patient doesn't know. They say, I'm coming here for smoking cessation. Why are you asking me about these other things? So it's really important to tell them and prep them that, look, when I'm asking about smoking, I'm going to ask you about your life, who you're with, where you hang out, what kinds of things you've done to quit smoking, and other questions that are related that make it harder to quit. Because as you know, with smoking, it connects. When somebody gets addicted to tobacco, it connects to everything in the person's life, every routine of their life, you know. So that's how it becomes connected to, you know, after waking up with their first cup of coffee, after a meal, you know, when they're relaxing, when they're stressed. And so that's why it's so difficult to quit smoking, because it sort of pushes its tentacles into every activity the person does. So that's one of the things that we spend some time making sure people understand, when we're asking these questions, it's not just to collect information, but it's to help them as they're thinking about quitting, how to do it, and what are some of the things. And often people will realize that, you know, when I'm drinking, there's no way I'm quitting. In fact, my cravings go up when I'm drinking. But what is very interesting, I'm seeing a patient right now who really drinks heavily every day. He works in a bar, he drinks every evening, and he came to quit smoking, and you know, you're smoking 40 cigarettes a day, and after 2 weeks, we've got him, you know, he was not interested in dealing with his alcohol, and I just saw him yesterday, and you know, we've got him up on two patches, and then he says, you know what, I've just realized that I'm not drinking as much, I'm not smoking, I don't feel like I need to drink as much, and he's suddenly brought down his daily drinking, where he was binging large amounts of alcohol to, you know, four drinks, and that came spontaneously from him without me saying anything. So part of it is that health behavior change occurs. You may collect that information at baseline, but it may be something that happens further down as they're coming, you know, and trying to make that quit attempt. So there's nothing to say that everybody has to quit all at the same time. It's better if they quit both at the same time, but because both they'll get a better outcome. But if sometimes people sequence it, and that's completely okay to sequence it, because sometimes people will say, no, I'm not ready to give up my drinking, but I'm trying to give up my smoking. And then they come in their follow-up visit and they say, yeah, you know what, drinking is coming in the way of me meeting my goal of quitting smoking, so I think I need to do something about the drinking, at least temporarily, increase my chances of quitting. So I think that is a big way in which how we deal with it. And with respect to denial, I think one of the things that we think about with denial is that, you know, our job is to break it down, or we have to get them to admit it's a problem. Often, you know, I will ask them, so given the amount of alcohol you drink, what concerns do you have about it? And if they say, I have no concerns, all my friends drink like that, my family drinks like that, that's our pattern of drinking, I'm fine, I'm working, I hold on a job, I pay the bills, and this is my recreation, then it's a question of saying, would it be getting permission to share some information? Would it be okay, you know, to share some information with you, because I am concerned of your overall health, not only today in this visit, but long term. And, you know, if you're open to it, I'll share that information with you. And so you can share that information. And it's not about confronting denial or the person is, you know, not willing to admit that they have a problem, because they may not have a problem. They're just exposing themselves to alcohol that could be causing them a future problem, not necessarily addiction, but health problems. So sometimes that's how, you know, I would approach the denial piece. clearly very different if somebody has a pure alcohol use disorder and they need to get in and they're trying to, you know, they're trying to minimize their consumption and they don't want to get into treatment. That's a whole different intervention, not necessarily part of this intervention. And that clearly is more rare than the person who seems to be drinking to excess. And I think the last thing that came up here as a barrier that I think is that healthcare providers use themselves, and I think that is one of the things that has become very apparent to us, is that healthcare providers, you know, we're part of the general population, and no one's talked to us about how much we should drink, and of course we are working, and we are showing up to work, and we are, you know, holding things down at home and doing everything else, and so if a patient is drinking, we're not going to ask them about that. So again, that is again, part of some of the reasons why we don't. So if we break it down into the areas, it's what we as providers often will judge as worthy to do, because we may not see that that is a variation, because then we may not know the guidelines, so we don't do it. Alternatively, we feel awkward, or we don't have the skills of how to navigate the issues of stigma and denial, and how to navigate to talk about when they're not there for alcohol, why would we bring it up? And the only way I think is legitimate to bring it up would be if you can help connect their drinking and smoking in the context of smoking cessation. So I'll end the poll then. I'm looking forward to, and I think what Ravinda says, who says one red wine per day is protective for my heart, actually, I think that question is a great question. I think it's really protective for people who are at high risk for heart disease, not necessarily others. And again, the protective effect comes from not necessarily red wine, but one standard drink of alcohol, 1 to 2 every other day rather than every day. So what I would tell people is that yes, your heart is one part of your body, but you have a brain, you have a liver, you have, you know, pancreas, you have a sleep system, and alcohol affects all of those as well. So, you know, what good is a beating heart if you've had a stroke, or if your liver's failed, or if you've got cancer? So, you know, how do you minimize your exposure, and what matters to you? So that's how often I will sort of, when people say this, you know, because that's what has been pushed in the media and has been pushed by the alcohol industry to create some doubt in people's mind. But if you go back to the science, there's a clear dose-response relationship with the harms. Now, people may want to tolerate different levels of harm because of the cultural aspects. And then you have to go with that. But at least, you know, you want to make sure people make an informed choice about it. And people do, you know, take risks all the time in their life. So that's fine. So I hope that answered that question of how one would approach that question. Now let's go to the second poll question and see how we're doing. So I think we're going to get the second poll. And feel free to keep typing in questions as we're going along. We have time for that. So, and we need the second, or the third, I guess, the ending, that one. Oops. Yeah. We'll go to the next slide. Okay. Thanks. All right. So now, yeah, we've got that. Okay. So I'm just going to go to the next
slide. Hi, Dr. Here. Selby. Sorry,
Hi.
Can you hear me? This the both polls were done already.
Okay. All right. So let's go to the next slide. Oops. All right. Okay. So let's open it up now for questions for the group around these topics about alcohol and smoking together, and how do we help some of these barriers that came up. And I presented something, but I wanted to open it up for the group for discussion. And maybe, Nadia, if you want to slide in as well, we can see. Maybe if that share will help, yeah. Stephanie, can you open up the line by phone or?
Yes, if anyone is interested in calling in and providing the response verbally, they can press star 1 to unmute their line. Or also you can type in the chat box as well.
And while people are thinking about their question, I would, here's one, so I can wait and pose my question later.
Yeah, I guess the issue that Caroline says is dealing with silos in healthcare. I deal with tobacco, he deals with alcohol, she deals with the body. I guess that is the way our health system is unfortunately evolving, but the more and more we look at trying to help people who use tobacco. I think I came to it from that perspective. The more and more I'm seeing it, I'm saying, oh my God, these people who are smoking have so many unmet needs. So we are just tapping one aspect of their life. But I think people who work in primary care settings are seeing all of these things. And, you know, the beauty, as I said, in primary care settings where you have a relationship is you can sequence it. You may identify it, but then you can work with the patient to say, okay, you know, we're going to deal with tobacco now, but whatever we can do together, what can we put together? Because we know tobacco and alcohol go together, and if you're ready to do those together, we can do that together, but otherwise we can, and if I work with my colleague who manages alcohol, you know, let's see if we can work together to help you. I think as the healthcare system matures, it's going to have to move away from us being focused on our job, but making sure that the patient experience is much better and integrated. So how do we do that, I think, is really critical. And, you know, this is why team-based work or making sure we all have generalist expertise is going to be critical for our patients who have these multiple problems and don't fall through the cracks. Sorry, you were going to say something?
There's another one, so I can wait and pose a question afterwards.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think Kim made a good point that the guidelines for alcohol are low risk and not no risk, exactly. So it's all about lowering risk, and I think even when you look at cannabis, lower risk guidelines, they are lower risk, and I don't think we have to say that they are no risk, right? And again, with the alcohol guidelines, and I think, you know, Nadia, you may want to comment on it, and as we've looked at the levels of alcohol consumption, they have different levels of risk, right?
That's right. So for cancer, for women, if you drink one drink a day, you're already increasing your cancer risk. And for men, it's two drinks a day, you're increasing your cancer risk. But that doesn't mean that if you drink a bit less, you're not increasing your cancer risk. It's just not as high.
And there's still, so that's part of it is, right, where, you know, so there's always a little bit of a signal. The question is, and I think this is where the patient's values matter rather than our values, what kind of risk are you willing to tolerate? If you take a look at the injury prevention guidelines or, you know, the low-risk drinking guidelines that get promoted, the amount of drinks that people are allowed are, you know, 14 drinks per week for men and 14 drinks for women and 21 for men, which is three drinks for men and two drinks for women. But again, you know, that, I mean, you know, for some people that may be too much. I mean, you know, even with that amount of consumption, that could affect them if they did it in they drove, for example, or they did some, you know, safety sensitive job. They should be drinking at all. So, or they're pregnant, or they have hypertension. That amount of consumption would be problematic. So, I think when we look at these guidelines on alcohol consumption, we have to make sure that we are matching it to the patient values and they understand at what level, what risk, and what risk do they want to take.
Yeah.
So they can make an informed decision. You know, clearly if somebody has alcohol use disorder or the traditional alcoholic where if one drink leads to 20 drinks, then no amount of alcohol is a safe amount for them because you're going to relapse. So, you know, so those are some of the considerations when we're looking at guidelines. And and I think as Kim said, I ask how much they know and if I can share my knowledge with them. I think that's a great way of getting permission to share this, because people, given the cultural significance of alcohol in our society, for some people that becomes an affront if a healthcare provider talks about consumption. So now you, Catherine is adding the cannabis use, and as we are seeing, yes, cannabis use also affects people's quitting, and you have cannabis, alcohol, tobacco. I think sometimes when we are taking our smoking history, what we are, you know, at least in our clinic, what we do is we highlight all the various things that we are seeing. We obviously thank them for sharing the information, and then we say, how does this all fit in together for you? If you're making a quit attempt, how is one going to affect the other? So as part of our problem solving and treatment planning, that's part of the real, you know, in the counseling, it's really important for these patients who are complicated, who have more than one health behaviors, to see how they see the connections. You know, so for our cannabis user who's smoking cannabis, putting tobacco in it, but is also drinking, you know, we are often helping them sort of sort it out and either sequence it or do it concurrently. And this is why it sometimes is not, you know, a one-time visit and then you just give them a, you know, and they go off and it's all, you know, it changes over every visit. But what is important is what we do is make sure we, clinically at least, and, you know, is to check in with them. How are things going and what's coming in the way of quitting smoking, what's coming in the way of quitting alcohol, what's coming in the way of quitting or moderating the cannabis. And yes, it does get complicated. And, you know, there aren't any good studies about how to do this. And so it's really clinical judgment about the principles of health behavior change that are helping us move forward with this population, because they are showing up in our clinic. Yeah. And I think, Caroline, because that's a good topic, is where mental health teams who often look at tobacco as a very low priority, and I think we're starting to see a lot of shifts in several teams where, you know, this is beginning to show up, and, you know, people are beginning to see that when people are smoking, they're much more likely to be agitated, they're much more likely to need high doses of benzodiazepines, they may need high doses of medications, the medications aren't working, the person's going poor, doesn't have food, and that when, or they can't attend groups because they're so heavily dependent, then suddenly the aha button goes off and smoking, addressing the smoking becomes a priority for that mental health team. And it's really about getting people to see that. I mean, I think we're seeing shifts in several parts of our system in Ontario. We're seeing a shift in the cancer system, which is not only doing smoking cessation for prevention, but now with cancer patients, they're seeing the benefits of smoking cessation. I think that is also coming in, and we're having some of the cancer teams now even trying to introduce alcohol interventions into their cancer, as part of their cancer treatments, because we know that that might be interfering with the outcomes. So it's about us getting our teams to sort of buy in and using that knowledge. The lack of knowledge is a big reason why our teams don't intervene, and I think we have to continue to do that. You know, that's one of the reasons why we have the TEACH program for people who, you know, people working in the mental health and addiction sector, to understand how and why they should intervene, and so there are resources there for them as well. And about making things non-judgmental, that's a good point. Right, and I like that suggestion, is to, when people see how alcohol is undermining their hard work quitting smoking, they're much more open to do that. So I think those are really great tips coming up from the audience, is that really getting people engaged and getting that connection is critical for people to understand. Now, so this, I think Mary brings up this issue about binge drinking. So binge drinking is a specific definition. So four or more drinks, standard drinks per occasion for women, or five or more for men, make it a binge. And why are binges important? Binges across all the alcohol research tend to suggest binge drinking is what is associated with harm, both immediate harm, like falls, injuries, those kinds of things, as well as cancer risk. In breast cancer risk, especially for women, binge drinking is the more robust association. So I think binge drinking is something we pick up, and it also is an indicator of binge drinking predisposes people to develop more significant problems with alcohol, like alcohol use disorders. So I think that is something for people to understand, is that this binge drinking on the weekend, which we often, and even young people are doing this non-normative drinking, of having all their alcohol consumption and getting wasted on the weekend, is way more problematic, whether it's on campus or whether it's in real life. It causes more injuries, accidents, etc. So I think getting people to learn how to say, okay, you know what, per drinking occasion, spread out your drinking over the week rather than at one time. And if they're open to tips and suggestions, you know, the low-risk drinking guidelines that available at CAMH, on the CAMH website, as well as in the resource prepared for combat, there are those elements of how to space your drinking. So, for example, generally the advice is try to have no more than one alcohol drink over an hour. So your body metabolizes one drink of alcohol per hour. So if you did that, you would essentially not get yourself in an intoxicated state. And of course, many people are seeking the intoxication, but if they want to drink alcohol socially, you drink one drink per drinking hour. And then if you want to reduce your consumption over the evening, you space that with a non-alcoholic drink for another hour. So you can reduce your consumption by half over an evening by simply alternating an alcohol drink with a non-alcoholic drink. Secondly, is choosing more dilute alcohols like beers and wines rather than the concentrated alcohols, which unfortunately has started to creep into society as the way of drinking. So shots have become very popular because people think it has less calories, especially young women. But if you look at the recent data that came out of ICS, the increase in emergency rooms by women because of alcohol have just gone up tremendously. So getting people to not drink concentrated forms of alcohol and having dilute alcohol, drinking alcohol on a full stomach, are all practical things that people can do to reduce their risk. And then often having one or two days in the week where there's, you know, which we often talk is recovery days for your body, are good ways for them to think about. Another thing about alcohol that people don't recognize, that although people say, well, I have a drink because it helps me fall asleep, really educate them that alcohol, especially when you're binging, is actually knocking you out. It's interfering with your REM sleep. And so what happens is you look like you've fallen asleep, but when it wears out, your body wakes up all at once. You don't actually wake up in a good state. You actually wake up in a worse state, and over time, you actually land up with a sleep disorder because of the drinking. And so alcohol is not good for your natural sleep rhythm patterns. And so people often don't know that. And the other thing that people don't recognize, especially as people getting older, that one of the biggest reasons for developing atrial fibrillation and arrhythmias is actually alcohol consumption. So people don't necessarily recognize these things, but those are all the things that we can help people. So it's not, alcohol is not just the cancer and smoking risk, but there's alcohol risk with injuries, heart disease, liver disease, pancreatic disease. So I think getting people to understand this, because there's no warning labels on alcohol in Canada. You know, nothing educates patients about the harms of alcohol, other than drinking and driving, which is something that people get. Other than that, nobody knows about the health effects and the effects that it's having. So other final comments or questions, or otherwise I'll just we'll just summarize what we are talking about, and if you have any questions or if you want access to the combat materials, you can put that up.
And if anyone has any comments on why patients were more likely to accept receiving a brief intervention and a resource, the patients that were in the CDFS group versus those who were not, anything that could give us an understanding of what was it about the CDFS that helped healthcare providers deliver the intervention better, or the patient to actually accept it, would be really beneficial. So if you could type any answers about that, I would really appreciate it.
Hi, it's Marilyn White Campbell here on the line. Dr. Selby, I wanted to mention that the Canadian guidelines for substance use for alcohol use disorder in older adults was just released, and those were one of the key recommendations was that we have labeling on alcohol, on the harms, and also at the point of pour. And the other is low-risk drinking guidelines for older adults, because they are 50% less than the recommended by CCSA due to the physiology of older adults and changes in late life with liver function and so on.
Exactly. Thank you, Marilyn, for bringing that up. Absolutely. So I think that you can see some of these advances that are occurring in our system. And that's a great resource. And I think if you're on a computer, feel free to type in the link to that so that people can get it. Or if you want to send it us, then we can put a link in into the presentation as well, so that if people have access to those that resource.
I'll send you the links. They will be up on the website in about a month and a half.
Okay. All right. Okay. So in the interest of time, we've got a few minutes left, and we're not hearing other questions coming up. We're going to say thank you for joining us, and thank